Thank you so much for joining us at Lifepoint Church online. If God is using this ministry to impact your life, we would love to hear about it and encourage you to share your story at lifepoint.org/story. If you'd like to partner with us financially and help expand our reach all over the world with the good news of Jesus, you can do so by clicking the Give button at the bottom of the page and selecting the option that works best for you. Or you can use our Text to Give option by texting the keyword LifePoint and the amount to the number 45777. Again, thank you so much for joining us. We hope that you are encouraged by today's message.
Well, how many goal setters do we have in the house? Anybody like to set goals? Come on, a couple of you. And some of you are like, no, I don't set goals. It means I have to do something. I like to set goals. I like to set financial goals in our family. I like to set health goals. I've told you before, I'm a runner. I like setting running goals. I like certain, you know, I'm going to break a time, or I'm going to run faster than I did the last one, or race. I like to set those kind of goals. I like to set goals for the church, obviously, things we want to attain to. I didn't say I was a goal hitter. I just said I like to be a goal setter. Come on, somebody else. Does that relieve you a little bit? You're like, oh, yeah, I do that. I do that, right? I'm a goal setter. I didn't say necessarily goal hitter, but I like to set some goals. Here's what I've learned about goals in my own life is this. As you set goals, it causes you to strive a little bit more than you probably would have otherwise. How many of you know that to be true? Like, even if you don't hit the goal, the fact that you set the goal makes you reach a little bit farther than you would have reached otherwise in your life, most likely. I've also learned this about goals, that goals help me give me direction. Because if I don't have any goals in life, then life will happen to me, and I want to happen to life. Like, I want to have a course set. I want to have some direction, and goals help me know the course that I need to take. And the thing about goals is this, is that setting a goal is admitting that you haven't yet arrived. And I think it would be good for all of us to admit that we haven't arrived in life, that you haven't arrived in any area of life, and specifically what we're talking about is relationships, that none of us have got to the place where we have perfect relationships in every area of my life. We're the perfect parent. We're the perfect spouse. We're the perfect employee. We're the perfect employer. We're the perfect child. We're the perfect student. Like, can we just all admit, like, if you came in with a church face, can you please take it off? We don't do that here. You came in thinking you got it all together. Can we just like admit we don't have it all together, that none of us, am I in the right church? None of us have got it all together. And so there's something more to strive for, that there's something in front of us that we could do better in certain areas of our life, that it's worth having a goal. And here's what I know about all of us, no matter where you are on the faith journey, and maybe you came today, somebody like said, hey, we're doing this relationship series, and you're like, man, I could use that. I don't know if I believe in God, but I could use that. No matter where you are on the journey, and I would say whether you've been walking with Jesus and known him for a long time, or you're just kind of checking out the faith, this church was for you, invented for you, planted for you, started for you, so that you can discover who Jesus is without all the trappings of religion, that you could encounter Jesus in relationship. And so, yeah, that's why we're here. It's good. But here's what I know about us is that no matter where you are on the faith journey, you want successful relationships. I don't think any of us go, I'm about to get married, and I hope at about year two, we blow this thing apart. Or, hey, we're expecting a kid, and I hope to ruin their life. Or, hey, I've got this new job, and I hope to be the worst employee this company has ever experienced. We don't approach that like that's not the intent of our heart. We want successful relationships, right? We want them to work out. We have some relationship goals. There's something in us that when we meet that couple that has been married for 45 years and they still love each other and they're still excited, we're like, relationship goal right there. Like, there's something in us that when we encounter those two friends and they've been friends forever through thick and thin, through hell and high water, they have stuck by each other's side. They've had each other's back. We go, relationship goal, I want that in my life. Whenever we meet that parent that, like, the kid is grown, they're out of the house, and they still want to come back and hang out with the parent, you're like, relationship goal, I hope my kids like me when they don't have to like me anymore. Come on, somebody. But how many of you know it's a lot easier to hashtag than it is to do? It's a whole lot easier to hashtag than it is to do it. Because I found out about goals and relationships that they take time, they take work, they take a whole lot of intentionality. That healthy God-honoring, I would say it this way, life-giving relationships take time, they take work, and they take a whole lot of intentionality. Because although it is possible for you to have life-giving relationships in every area of your life, I have found that it is not probable. It is possible, but it's not always probable because sometimes we just think it's going to happen. But here's what I know. You don't stumble into great relationships. You don't stumble and one morning wake up and go, I'm an amazing spouse. I mean, if there was a ranking, I'm in the top 10. Right? Like, that just doesn't happen. You don't just wake up one day and you're like, I kill it as a parent. Like, I just kill it. I mean, let's just say it. Like, I kill it. It just doesn't, you don't wake up one day and you're like, I'm an amazing friend. Like, I should be the mayor of Friendville. Like, not because you can't get a date, because you're an amazing friend. Oh, sorry, that was underhanded, that was cold. I had a buddy in school that he was like, every girl I meet wants to, I'm like the mayor of Friendville. They don't want to be serious, they just want a friend. I'm like, friend of Friendville, I'm mayor of Friendville. Anyways, you don't just stumble upon those things. It just doesn't wake up one day and it just happens that you have this incredible marriage, that you have these incredible friends. That it just doesn't happen that you wake up and you have these amazing children, or that you're an incredible employee, or you wake up one day and you're just an amazing employer and business owner. It just doesn't happen. You don't just stumble into it. It takes time and it takes work and it takes a whole lot of intentionality. It takes a lot of time. Are y'all with me? It takes a whole lot of work. And it takes a whole lot of intentionality. But I found that sometimes relationships aren't that successful in our life because we're living in the wrong circle. See, there's two circles in your life, really. There's the circle of concern, and there's the circle of control. The circle of concern and the circle of control. Somebody shout concern.
Concern.
Come on, every campus, and shout control. And a lot of us are trying to control what we should be concerned with, and we're only concerned with what we should be controlling. We think our relationship would get better if I could just make them do this or that. Well, Pastor, my marriage would be better if he would just do this, if she would just do, if I could just get them to. I meet people that are engaged that are like, we're so excited about getting married. You know, everything's wonderful. Well, let's talk through the struggles. Well, there's really no struggles. I mean, he does these few things that kind of aggravate me, but we're going to work them out when we get married. Jesus, fix the stupid in them right now. In the name of Jesus, Jesus, help them, Jesus. Because they is dumb. And they need revelation. Y'all with me? And so we're trying to control the other person in the dynamic, no matter what it is, marriage, dating, friendship, employment, no matter the context of the relationship, we're trying to control the other person when we should be controlling the thing we only can control, and that is the person you look at in the mirror every day, yourself. And I'm not saying you shouldn't be concerned. There are things worth being concerned about. There are friends in your life that are making horrible decisions and throwing their life away. And I'm not saying don't be concerned about them. I'm not saying don't pray for them. I'm not saying don't offer counsel to them. But what I'm saying is you cannot control them. Even in your home, you can have an illusion of control over your children. And you may be able to control to a place where they modify behavior in front of you. But if Jesus doesn't grab a hold of their heart, then true change will never happen on the inside. So even in your home, you think, well, I control my kids. Well, you may in front of you. But really, the only sphere of control is you. You should draw the circle around you and go, what I can deal with is me. And so I preached a message, I don't know how many years ago, called this, to bring the best me to the we that you possibly can. Throughout this series, I want to help you be the best you can possibly be. Because when you bring a better me to the we, then the we gets a whole lot better. But when you spend all of your time and energy trying to control the other person, then you will find out you will be frustrated. And you will find out that your relationships will be dysfunctional because all you can control, honey, is you. Are you with me? Control what you can control. Control you. Deal with you. Fix you. The better you, the better we. Are you with me? So if you're going to deal with you, you've got to know who you are. I'm not talking about like, I like long, long walks on the beach. My favorite color is purple. You know? I like a cabin in the mountains with fire pit and yeah, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about like you, like what makes you up? What makes you function the way you function? What makes you act the way you act? What causes you to respond the way you respond? You've got to know you. If you're going to be the best you can possibly be, then you got to know who you is. I know that wasn't good grammar. And so the Bible says this in 1 Thessalonians 5:23. It says, "May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through." And now read this next part. Look at this. "May your whole what?
Spirit,
soul, and body," keep that in mind, "be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ." May your spirit, soul, and body. Spirit, soul, and body. So if you're going to control you, if only you can be responsible for you, then here's what the Bible says you are made up of. Spirit, soul, and body. This is who you are. Are you with me? Say amen.
Amen.
Let me illustrate this for you. You are made up of spirit, soul, and body. Somebody shout body.
Body.
Now, you may like your body, you may not like your body, you may like the shape of your body, you may not like currently the shape of your body, I don't know, but you have a body. Listen to me though, you are not a body. Are you with me? I told you you're going to have to lean in to get this. This is going to help your relationships. You're like, what does this have to do with my relationships? You hang with me, I'll show you at the end. I'll put a nice bow on it and it'll be awesome. Who you are is not your body. You have a body. And your body was formed by God, not created by God, formed by God. The Bible says that God created some things in Genesis that he spoke, and out of nothing came something. That is creating. Are you with me? Say amen. Are you with me?
Amen.
Every campus. God, in Genesis 2, said that he formed man in his own image out of the dust of the earth, okay? Out of the dust of the earth. So he formed. So to form means I take something that already exists and I make it into something else. That is forming. Creating means I take something that was not there and then I, now it is there, I create it. Are you with me? So God formed your body. Your dad had some seed. You should really take your kids to Kids Point. Dad has seed, Mom? What does that mean? We plant corn in the backyard, honey. Your mom had an egg. God took two things that already existed and formed you. David said in Psalms 139 that God formed me and knitted me together in my mother's womb. Are you with me? So you're formed. So you have a body. You have a body. You are not a body. You have a body. This is why whenever you die, your body will go back to the earth. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Isn't that what they say at the graveside? Why? Because you came from the dust and you will return to the dust, right? Because what you came out of is what you will return to. So you are not a body. You have a body. Are you getting this? You are not a body. I want you to understand that. You are not the ears you see and the nose you see and the hands you see. This is what is housing you, but it is not you because it is not eternal. You will get a new body. I don't want to go off track too much. You will get a new body in heaven, a body that, like mine, will have six pack. It will not go gray, and it will never get sick. Come on, somebody. And I won't even have to do crunches to get it. But the body that you see me in now will return to the dirt. All right? Now, who I am is a spirit. I'm a spiritual being having an earthly experience, not an earthly being having a spiritual experience. There's a big difference. I am a spiritual being that is temporarily having an earthly experience, but my spirit will live forever somewhere. And where it lives is up to you. It depends on what you do with Jesus. Now, if you have placed your faith in Christ, whenever you accept Christ, whenever you are saved, your spirit is made alive. Your spirit is, it comes to life. This is what Jesus said. You still hanging with me? I told you we're going to do some teaching today. Here's what Jesus happened in John chapter 3. Nicodemus came to Jesus, and Nicodemus was a spiritual leader of the day, and he came to Jesus, and he said, what must I do to be born again? And Jesus said, or what must I do to be saved? Jesus said, Nicodemus, you got to be born again. And Nicodemus goes, how can I be born of the flesh again? In other words, Nicodemus like, how can I go back into my mother's womb, which is kind of like awkward and weird to think about. For your mom, painful. And Jesus said, no, you're not understanding what I'm saying. You've been born of the flesh once, but you've got to be born of the spirit. So your body is already alive because you're sitting here, you're breathing, but something else inside of you has to be made alive, and that is your spirit. Are you with me? And so that's why we talk around here that we want to see people who are far from God, disconnected from God, be made fully alive in Christ. Because there's a part of you that is not alive until you encounter Jesus. That's why Jesus said in John 10:10, I've come that you might have life and that you might have it to the full, or you might be fully alive. He said, in other words, I'm going to preach a little bit. I'm going to get out teaching, preach a little. He said, I've come to do something on the inside of you that you could not do for yourself. I've come to awaken something on the inside of you. There is a spirit man on the inside of you that is the real you that needs to be made alive to the destiny and the purpose and the plan of God for your life. Are y'all with me? And so that's what happens when you accept Christ. Your spirit is made alive. So you have a body. You are not a body. You are a spirit. Your spirit is made alive when you encounter Christ. But there's a problem. Because he said, not only do we have spirit, body, we also have soul. We can use the word mind. It's interchangeable in the scriptures. We have our mind. I just broke my pen. So you have a mind. Your mind is what the Bible refers to as your soul. Somebody shout, mind. This is also your will. This also is your emotions could fit into this category. And so here's what happens in our life and becomes the challenge for us is this, is our spirit has been awakened. And so the Spirit of God begins to work in our life and leads us towards what the Spirit wants for us, but it has to filter through our mind, and often our mind is cluttered with baggage and garbage and blockage, which keeps us from living out in our body the life that God intended for us. Let me illustrate this for you. Your life has been transformed by Jesus. You've got some relational conflict in your life. Someone's hurt you in the past, and you feel the Spirit of God going, you need to forgive them. You really need to forgive them. You need to let it go. Your mind pops up and goes, you don't know what they did to me. They don't deserve forgiveness. They were jerks. They hurt me deeply. They hurt me really bad. They rejected me. They walked out on me. Are you kidding me? I'm not going to forgive them. The Spirit of God's going, no, you need to forgive them. And it works through the filter of our mind to eventually, so the words come out of our mouth, I forgive you, and we mean them. But it has to get through our mind, or what the Bible calls our soul. Are you with me? And our will is going, I don't want to. Our emotions are going, I don't feel like it. Our mind, will, and emotions get all like, because our soul, our mind, will, and emotions are working and warring against the Spirit. Are you with me? And our body, the Bible says the flesh is at enmity, or it's opposing, it's at war with the spirit. And so for a lot of us, our dysfunction in our relationships, we think, well, if he would just do this, if she would just do that. No. If you would begin to purify the filter through which the Spirit of God is wanting to work in your life, then it would come out in your life and you would have transformation in your relationships. Well, no, Pastor, you don't understand. It's my ex-husband. That's why I'm the way I am. It's my mom and dad. That's the way. It's that company that treated me wrong. That's why I've got walls up and bitterness, and that's why I act that way at work. And Pastor, you know, no, and I'm not wanting to downplay in any way the pain of those experiences. But I'm saying the dysfunction in your relationship is prolonged when you continue to think that way. When you continue to allow those things to become caps, barriers, and blockage to the Spirit of God transforming you and transforming the relationships around you. Listen to me very clearly. You are currently living at the level of your thinking. What you are getting in life is perfectly in line with the level of your thinking. And if I can elevate your thinking, I can elevate your living. If I can get you to think different about the relationships in your life, then your relationships will begin to change in your life because you live according to how you think. Let me give you an example. If you think that putting a vacation on a credit card at 20% interest is a great idea, then you'll be vacationing all year. And you'll be left with the regret of debt. And I can't ever seem to get it. You didn't charge that on that vacation because it felt great. You charged it on there because something in your thinking was broke. And because your thinker was broke, your living is broke. Is this too hard? I'm trying to help you now. If you would elevate your thinking, then you would elevate your living, right? Some people come to me and they say, Pastor, you know, yeah, I mean, it sounds nice and it sounds romantic, right? Like, I've just met someone and they complete me. They complete me. We have synergy. We feel each other. I get the sentiment, but here's the deal. In relationships, two halves don't make a whole. Two halves make two broke people. Are you with me? You don't find someone that is like half broke and you're half broke. Are you following me? I'm saying we all got issues, but if you would say, I'm going to be the best me, I'm going to clean up the filter as much as I can. I'm going to feed my spirit. I'm going to surrender my mind to the will of God and the mind of God so that the Spirit of God can flow through my life. And then in every relationship, you know what? When you do that, you'll be a better friend. When you do that, you'll be a better employee. When you do that, you'll be a better employer and business owner, whatever you'll be a better husband. You'll be a better wife. You'll be a better parent. If you would focus on God, I want to surrender my mind to your mind. I want to feed my spirit because I want the Spirit of God to have an easy pass through. I don't want anything blocking God's Spirit working in and through me. And I'm not talking about, some of you are like, I don't know if I want God's Spirit working in. I had some friend that talked about God's Spirit and they were weird. Can I just tell you, people that are weird and they talk about the Spirit of God, they're just weird. They were weird before God, they're weird after God, they're just weird. Spirit of God isn't going to make you do weird things. But he probably will ask you to do things that are counter to the culture you live in. But I just want to say, if lacking integrity is normal, I want to be weird. If lack of commitment and not sticking it out with someone through thick and thin, if that is normal, let me be abnormal. If having purity in my relationships is abnormal, then if that's normal in a culture, let me be abnormal. Let me go against the flow because I want everything that God has for me and I want everything that God has for you. Romans 12:2, is this helping? Yes. Romans 12:2 says it this way, do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your, what? Shout it. Mind. Say it again. your mind. So don't be conformed to the pattern of this world. So the Spirit of God says, forgive. The pattern of this world says, you get me, I'll get you back. Don't be conformed to the pattern of this world, but renew your mind, because if you don't renew your mind, the Spirit will want to lead you to something and you'll resist it because your mind isn't renewed. If the pattern of this world says, hold on to bitterness and hold on to anger and build up walls and don't trust anybody and don't let anybody in and don't be kind to anybody and get what's yours and look out for you and don't look out for anybody else and only love people that love you back. But God says, no, 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 be transformed by the renewing. Let my word transform your mind and I will empower you through the Spirit to live it out. Come on, somebody put their hands together. This is pretty preaching right here. And so you can't control what's yours if you don't know who you are. And you are a spirit. You have a soul, and you live in a body. Don't forget that. You are a spirit. That's why you need to be in these environments. You know why? Because as the word is preached, it's feeding your spirit, and it's cleaning out your mind. This is why you need to, we talk about getting in a small group. We're not trying to reach some quota. We don't make commission on small group or something. We want to get you an environment where the word of God feeds your spirit and cleans out your mind. So the Spirit of God has a clean pass through to work in and through your life. He said, Romans 12:2, he says, don't be conformed to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know, Tammy and I, we like to entertain people in our house. All the extroverts are like, yeah, we do too. All the introverts are like, please get away. I like to entertain people for periods of time because I'm naturally an introvert. And so I don't want you over for like 8 hours, but 2 or 3 is good. Anybody with me? Like, 2 or 3 is good. Like, kind of get the signal. When we're wrapping up, we start putting dishes away. It's like, it's been great having you. Bye-bye. Right? But so we like to entertain. And somehow, I don't know why, it's just like, I don't know if there's a draw, a magnetic field in my kitchen or something, but everybody ends up in the kitchen. Anybody that happens at your house? Like, everybody ends up in the kitchen. We got this island, everybody ends up around the island, and I'm a grazer. You know, I like to graze. Like, if any food gets put out before it's all out, I'm picking a piece. I'm actually like, wait until Tammy leaves the room. I'm like, she's gone, I can eat. She'd be like, don't eat that, right? But eventually, like, Tammy wants everybody to move into the kitchen or into the dining room. She wants everybody. She's like, don't stand. Let's all go sit down. Because she's like, a meal is an experience for her. Like the presentation, how the food looks. Like even Chick-fil-A. I was laughing with her the other day. I was like, you eat Chick-fil-A so delicately. Like she's like. She'll set it down, talk a little while, enjoy the meal. Like, I'm still in college mode. I'm like, what's next? I got to get to class. Where do I got to go? Y'all with anybody with me? But she wants everybody to come in, and she wants, because she loves to entertain people. Like, she's great at entertaining people. She wants them to have an incredible experience with them entertained, right? And so we sit around the table, and when we sit around the table, we, like, share stories and have conversation. We laugh around the table, and it's a great time. Around the table, we love to entertain people and hear from people. And sometimes games will get brought out. I hate games, but I'm playing them for the sake of building relationships with my children. And I just like to win, and so they never end good. Sometimes they end with me cheating, and that's not good for my morality. But I win in the end, so I like winning. And so, anyways, we sat around the table. Let me ask you this. At the table of your mind, what are you entertaining? What do you entertain at the table of your mind? Who do you allow to pull up a seat and sit with you at the table of your mind? Because I feel like for some of us, some of the dysfunction or the rub or the challenges in our relationship is that we are entertaining the wrong things at the table of our mind. That we allow assumption to sit down with us and have a conversation. That we allow mistrust to sit down with us and begin to speak into our mind. We allow lies and half-truths and inconsistent. We allow all kinds of things to sit at the table, and they're constantly speaking in. So as the Spirit of God begins to lead us towards better and more life-giving relationships, our mind is so cluttered because we've allowed so many things to sit down at the table of our mind that have no business being there. And so I want to give you, in the last few minutes I have today, and over really the next 5 weeks, I'm going to give you things to entertain at the table of your mind. I want to give you three things I think that should be at every table, everybody's table, in your mind. So let me start with this. Number one is we should always, always entertain truth. Truth. John 17 says, "Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth." Truth should always be able to pull up a seat in the table of your mind. The truth. The Bible says sanctify them. In other words, the word sanctify means just purify. In other words, getting out the mess, getting in the good. Sanctify them by your truth. And then he tells us how to do that. Your word is truth. God's word should always have a seat at the table of your mind. I would say it this way. God's word should always be the loudest person. You know, you got that one person that you invite them over. Like everybody's trying to talk and they're like, "Hey, did you have a down there?" You're like, "Can you turn down the volume on your mouth?" That's what I tell my kids. "Hey, turn the volume down on your mouth. Can we get down to about a 4? You're at an 8 right now." God's word should always be the loudest voice at the table of your mind. Because here's what happens for some of you. You've allowed lies and half-truths to pull up a seat at the table. And you've created this whole scenario in your mind about people in your life that isn't even true. Because lies and assumptions and half-truths, you've allowed them to pull up a seat and you entertain those thoughts. "Well, they didn't call me back. I bet they're upset with me. You know what? Now that I think about it, they didn't text me back last week. And I bet they're trying to pull away. I wonder if I did something." And we're like, why are you letting them sit at your table? Why are you letting those voices and that junk sit at? I'll never have a marriage that I dreamed of after that last divorce. Who told you that? Who sat at your table and started speaking that junk? "Well, they broke up with me again, and I'll just never be loved in the way that I want to be loved." Who said that? Who did you allow to pull up? Some of you in this series need to determine that the voice of lies and half-truths and of assumptions, and you're going to decide, I'm going to show them the front door, and they can get out of the house of my mind. They don't belong. They don't have a seat at my table anymore. I'm going to allow the Word of God, who says, "I've got good plans for you. They're to prosper you and not to harm you. That no weapon formed against you will prosper. That you are completely and totally loved. That God so loved you, He let Jesus die on a cross for you." That the voice of truth in your life is going to be the loudest voice at the table of your mind. That lies must go. That half-truths must go. That the enemy must get out. He isn't invited. You need to be like, "Find the door. Find the door. I'm not going to allow lies to pull up a table, a seat at the table of my mind. I cannot entertain them. I can't hear from them. Because I've got to create a pure filter. I want the Spirit of God to have no hurdles to jump over to work in and through my life. So I'm going to let truth." You know, Hebrews 4:12 says that the Spirit of God is power, or the Word of God is powerful. It's like a double-edged sword dividing asunder the spirit and the soul. The Word of God has a way of cutting in there and going, no, that spirit, no, that's your mind. No, that spirit, no, that's your bad thinking. No, that spirit, if you will allow it, the Word of God will get in there like a scalpel and go, no, 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 this is God and this ain't God. This is God and this is, let this stay at the table. Let that take a walk out of the house and get a, I don't have much time, 6 minutes. Number two, not only do we need to entertain truth, somebody shout truth. We need to entertain honor. Honor should always have a seat at the table of your mind. Honor. Listen to what Romans 12:10 says. It says, love each other with genuine affection and take delight in honoring each other. In other words, honor. See, here's the deal. When the Spirit of God, let me show you this. The other services didn't get this. This isn't just behavior modification. It's spirit-empowered when the Spirit of God is working through you to do this. So truth, empowered by the Spirit, is transformational. Are you with me? Honor, when I choose to honor, empowered by the Spirit, it's not, well, I'm just going to try to be better. I'm going to try to work harder. I'm going to try to, you know, just honor people more. No, it's the Spirit of God empowering you to do it because your mind has been saturated with the things of God. Are you with me? The word honor simply means this, to esteem or to anticipate. Let me just ask you this. How would it change the relationships in your life at every campus if you determined that honor always had a seat at the table of your mind? How would it change your friendships if your friends knew that whether they were with you or they were not with you, the words you spoke about them to people were always words of elevating them, not tearing them down? That's honor. How would it change your friendships if you had a friend that you knew had been killing it all night long on a paper and had a final the next morning and you got up early and you went to Starbucks and you got them their favorite drink and you got it venti and you got extra shots of espresso in it because you knew they hadn't slept and you just knocked on the door and said, here, I know you were killing it all night long. I just want you to know you're going to kill it on this test today and here's a drink. I just want to show you some honor. How would that change your relationships? Let me ask you this. How would it change your working relationships and maybe your you know, future in employment if you decided, I'm going to show honor to my boss, I'm going to show honor to my peers, and I'm going to show the honor to those who work for me? What if you turned in the report before the boss ever asked for the report because you knew the report was needed? That's honor. That's anticipating it. How would it change? Well, I ain't going to be like a suck-up in the office. That's being a suck up. Following Romans 12:10, taking delight in honoring each other. I just think it's godly living. And can I tell you something? Honor gives access. Honor opens doors you can never open yourself. And honor attracts the favor of God. People that don't like honor don't like promotion and don't like raises. I'm just saying. How would it change your marriage if you decided to always entertain honor at the table of your mind? How would it change if your spouse knew that whether I'm with them or not with them, I know that they never speak a negative word about me? I'm not saying you don't have friends that you can open up to and share about struggles and challenges, but that ain't everybody. That ain't Facebook. Help us, Jesus. Honor means to anticipate. How would it change your marriage relationship if you got up in the morning and you decide, you know what, before she ever gets up, I'm going to do the things, her routine in the morning so that she has more time so that she can get ready. I'm going to try to anticipate the things that she has to do so that I can be a blessing and a help. It may change things when you get home that night. You know what I'm saying? Honor goes a long way. I need to move along. Number three. Entertain love. Love should always be able to have a seat at the table of your mind. Mark says it this way in chapter 12. I love the Message paraphrase. It said, Jesus said, the first in importance is, listen, Israel, The Lord your God is one. So love the Lord your God with all your passion, all your prayer, and intelligence and energy. And here's the second. Love others as well as you love yourself. There's no other commandment that ranks with these. No other commandment. But Pastor, I never miss a Sunday. I read my Bible every morning. The Bible says without love, you're like clanging cymbals. You're just a noisy mess if you don't love people. The thing I love about this verse is that it's not just principle, it's process. The principle is love God, love people. The process is love God first and then people. You know why? Because you can't truly love people unless you love God first. Not because you don't have the capacity to love people. It's because there are some people in our life that are hard to love. And if you don't move in the direction of loving God first, there's some people that you'll think you're exempt from loving. But here's what I've discovered is that I love God, as I love God more, I get a greater picture of His love for me. And I'm overwhelmed by how patient He is with me. I'm overwhelmed by how consistent He is in my inconsistencies. I'm overwhelmed by the moments I reject Him. He never, ever rejects me. It's kind of like what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 13, but the greatest of these, faith, hope, and love, but the greatest of these is love. Because here's the deal, there's going to be some people in your life that it's hard to entertain love. But when you realize how patient God is with you, you can extend that patience to others. When you can realize how consistent God is with you and your inconsistencies, you can be consistent to someone when they've been inconsistent to you. It's principle and process. It's interesting to me the way it's phrased here. It says, love others as well as you love yourself. You know, for some of you, the rub in your relationships is your ability to love others. And the reason you have a hard time loving others is if you haven't yet learned to love you. I'm not talking about becoming egocentric and making you the center of the world. I'm talking about just getting a revelation that with all your hang-ups, all your habits, and all your issues, God loves you just like you are. And He loves you so much, He doesn't leave you there. He wants to take you to greater and greater places. He wants to take you to more and more freedom. But He loves you just like you are. If you could get that revelation, you could begin to love you right where you are. And if you'll learn to do that, you'll learn to love others with all their hang-ups, all their habits, and all their issues. Church, you can only control you. Your relationships aren't going to be fixed because you dragged somebody to this series. Your relationships are going to be transformed because you transform your thinking. And I hope you'll make it a point to stick out every Sunday, because I'm going to help every week to elevate your thinking a little bit so I can elevate your living and elevate every relationship in your life. Do you receive it today? Do you receive God's word today? Come on, will you pray with me at every campus? If you would just bow your head and close your eyes. I just want you to ask you to consider two questions. Number one is, what is God saying to you today? I just know God has a way of, in these moments, kind of pointing directly at what it is in your life that He wants to have a conversation with you about. Maybe you're thinking, Pastor, I don't know God. He doesn't talk to me. I bet if you listen, He does. What's God saying to you? And number two, what are you going to do about it? What you're hoping for, or praying for, or dreaming about in all of your relationships, they're not going to happen just because you come every week. Not just because you hear the word, they're going to happen because you do the word. So what are you going to do about what God has spoken to you about? Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you that the word of God speaks to just really every area of our life. And I just pray for everyone under the sound of my voice today, that as you speak to them in that really gentle way that you do, I pray that they'd have the courage and the boldness to respond, to make the change that they need to make. Not the change they think somebody else needs to make, not the change they wish someone else would make beside them, behind them, in the row over, the change they need to make to become everything that you want them to be. God, would you elevate our thinking so in turn it would elevate our living, transform the relationships around us. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen. Amen. Let's thank God for his word today.